Hey, I'm Clint Garrett, Ace Networker, and in this video, we're going to continue on with our network switches and switching, and we're going to talk about something that I didn't cover in this video. If you watched this video on spanning tree, I went into some of the basic details about spanning tree on layer 2 switches and why we need spanning tree on layer 2 switches. In this video, we're going to talk about spanning tree protocol root bridge election. What is the root bridge? Why do we need a root bridge? Why do switches decide there's going to be a root bridge? Gonna get into that. Gonna get into all those nifty, fun little details. Coming right up.
Are you ready?
Okay, so again, if you watched this video on spanning tree, I went into some of the basics and I used this whiteboard to kind of give you some basic ideas about how spanning tree works and why we need it. It's used for the third major function of a layer 2 switch, and that is loop avoidance. So it's called spanning tree protocol, STP, and in some cases I'm going to get on the whiteboard as I did in the spanning tree video, the first one. In this case, I'm going to go straight to the animations because I'm going to try to use the same diagram, the same layout that I used in that spanning tree video. So let's get to it and let's get into the root bridge election. Spanning tree protocol root bridge election is what really makes spanning tree function correctly on a local area network to prevent those loops from existing. Now, if you watched this other video on spanning tree protocol, STP, you saw me explain the basics for how layer 2 switches use spanning tree to prevent those loops from existing and why it has to prevent those loops. But I also want to quickly cover how spanning tree started and show you what the root switch is and how the root switch plays into spanning tree. Spanning tree protocol started back when a company that's today called Compaq was originally called Digital Equipment Corporation, or DEC. They actually created the original version of spanning tree protocol, and it was later adopted, modified, and used by the IEEE into the IEEE's own version known as 802.1D. A little side note here, you may or may not need to know that for the Network Plus exam, but you will definitely need to know that for the CCNA and the CCNP exams if and when you decide to move up to those, and you'll definitely need to know that if you get into computer networking as a serious career or business anyway. Presently, most or all Cisco switches, or up to the present time, they've been running 802.1D version of spanning tree, and it's not compatible with the old DEC version that was used back in the day. And really, more importantly, most new layer 2 switches are using what's called rapid spanning tree protocol, or RSTP. So we'll get into that as we go into future videos. Just know that that's basically the history of spanning tree protocol in a very simplified form. That brings us to today. Today's spanning tree hasn't really changed very much as far as the basics of how it functions, although there is a new loop prevention technology on the horizon called Trill, and that's still being developed and still being modified so that we can potentially use it in the future. Trill stands for Transparent Interconnect of Lots of Links, so we'll get into that as we go into future videos. Again, for the Network Plus exam, you don't need to necessarily know this. There are also a lot of Cisco technologies that are kind of being used and protocols that are being used to try to make networks a little more efficient in their loop prevention than even what spanning tree can do. And again, we'll get into those as we go along. For the most part, we're still using some form of spanning tree protocol across the board on most layer 2 switches on most networks. For now though, we want to look at the root switch in spanning tree on a local area network. What it is, why it's needed, how it's used. Okay, so in the last video on spanning tree, I showed you a basic setup, and I showed you a local area network with 5 switches, and I'm going to draw those out again. We had a router here that's kind of our router that was connected to the outside network, and I'll just draw the basics of it here. You've got the cloud or the internet out here that this is connected to, and then usually you'll have one major switch connected to that router, and then we had 4 other switches out here. These were just on our local area network. And we'll assume that those are connected by network cables. Cat5, Cat6E, Cat7 Ethernet cables. They don't necessarily have to be. These can be just about any type of connection. running between these devices. We also said that spanning tree is a loop prevention technology. So what spanning tree is trying to do is it's trying to prevent you from connecting loops that would cause broadcasts. Now we're going to get into spanning tree protocol root bridge election, and what the root bridge is the switch on your local area network that all other layer 2 switches running spanning tree will try to create the fastest and most efficient path back to. So in most cases, not every scenario, and when we get into per VLAN spanning tree, multiple spanning tree down the road here in future videos, you'll deal with more of the semantics of where that root bridge is on that instance of spanning tree. You may have per VLAN spanning tree where you've got spanning tree running on each VLAN on the same switches and devices. Your root bridge may be different on one VLAN than it is on another VLAN. Regardless, the root bridge on an instance of spanning tree, and for this basic understanding of root bridge, we're going to just have one instance of spanning tree existing on this small network. The root bridge becomes the switch, the layer 2 switch, that all other switches are trying to create the fastest path back to while they're preventing loops, while they're avoiding loops existing for those broadcast storms that we talked about in that other video. They are trying to create the fastest path back. So in a nutshell, what in most cases what you want, if you have one instance of spanning tree, in most instances, again, this isn't set in stone or anything, this depends on how you have a network set up, but in most instances you want that root bridge to be this switch next to your router going out to an internet or to an external network of some kind. You want all other switches, while they're preventing those loops from existing, whether it's a loop between two switches like this with an extra cable or cables connected or connections made, or an overall loop in the overall network, and sometimes multiples of those can exist. Whatever it is, when these switches are trying to prevent loops from existing, they also are trying to create the fastest path back to the root bridge. Now, again, I'm going to get into more detail in that, but for the Network Plus exam, all you really need to understand is the function of the root bridge and why we have to have a root bridge on spanning tree. So, for this example, we're going to say that we have left these switches, we have not configured the priority setting for spanning tree on any of these layer 2 switches on this network. We've just let them at the default. Okay, so there are two ways that your switches on your network that are running spanning tree will determine who the root switch is going to be. And why do we have a root switch? We have a root switch because we need to know where the most efficient path is. All the switches on your network that are running spanning tree need to know where the most efficient path is to the most important switch on your local area network. That becomes your root switch. But there are two different ways that happens. One is through the election process. And I'll just give you an example of this. Most, if not all, layer 2 switches start out with a default priority, a spanning tree priority of 32,768. And this is called the priority. That combined with the MAC address, the primary MAC address of that particular switch, is looked at and it's advertised out from each switch on spanning tree. Let's say you leave all of these at default, you don't come in and configure the priority on the configuration of each switch or on any of these switches on your network. You leave the priority at the default of 32,768. Now, this is a number that's divisible by 4,096, and we'll get more into detail on that later, but we're just really dealing with the root bridge here. Why do we have a root bridge? Why do we need one? So, the root bridge is going to be the most important switch that all the other switches will need to get the most efficient path back to, the fastest path and the most efficient path back to, while they are blocking existing loops or doing loop avoidance on your network. So to make this really simple, if we start all these switches up on your network, we have them connected with, say, network cables here, and we leave them at default, we don't change any of the configurations on them, we leave them at 32,768. If, say, for instance, this switch over here has a MAC address that ends in 1111, and this one has 5555, and this one, say, has 3333, and this one has 2222, and maybe this one has 4444, what they will do is they will advertise out, my priority number is this, and every single one of them will default to that, 32768, and my MAC address is this. And so all of these switches on this network, if left at default and not change, would elect this switch as the root bridge. They would then determine any loops that exist, I'm going to block what interfaces I need to leave the most efficient path back to that root switch. Now this can occur if an administrator or a technician or whoever's setting up and configuring these switches on your network isn't configuring the root priority, at least on the switch that they want to be the root switch. So I've seen this happen. You'll take an old switch or you take a new switch and plug it in on some back end of your network, and it may have the lowest MAC address, and when it advertises that out, all the other switches say, oh, well, it's the root switch. That may not be the case. That may not be how you want your traffic directed. So that's the election process. That's step number one. Step number two is you as the administrator or the technician go in and you configure the priority for spanning tree on every switch, or you leave most of them at the default and you set the priority to a root priority, which is the lowest number you can set that priority to. Defaults at 32768, but you can set it to 4096. So if you wanted this to be the root switch, you would set the priority to 4096. That way, it doesn't matter what the MAC address is on all the others. If they all have 32768 as their default priority, along with whatever MAC address they have, this one will still have the lowest value. So it becomes the root switch, and when it advertises out, my priority is 4096. Why? Because you as the administrator or this technician configured that switch that way on its configuration. You logged into it and you configured it that way. It now has the lowest number value. Because it has the lowest number value, all these other switches, these other four switches, are going to see that as the root bridge. And while they're blocking loops, they're going to determine, hey, I have the most efficient path back to the root bridge. Now, we're going to get into more detail on this later on, but this is the primary function of the root bridge, is to be the most important switch in that spanning tree topology. Now, this is a default topology of just one instance, what they call an instance, of spanning tree on this local area network. We will get more detail about per VLAN spanning tree, where you have multiple VLANs configured on your network, and each one has a different version or instance of spanning tree running. You may have four VLANs set up on your network, and on one of the VLANs, this may be the root switch. But on the other three VLANs, maybe this is the root switch. Depending on how you want to direct your traffic and how important that root switch is in that instance of spanning tree. But just to give you an idea of the root bridge, this is one instance of spanning tree, and that is how the root bridge is determined and why we need it and how it's used. It's always recommended, in most cases, that you as the administrator, the technician, go in and configure the priority number on the root bridge that you intend to be the root bridge. You can also, when you get more elaborate networks, you can set up priorities of 8196 as a secondary route. So if something happened to this root bridge, let's say this one had a connection to the router over here, it would become the root switch if something happened to this switch here. Say something happened to this switch and it went down, having you configured a secondary priority number, which is a little higher number than this one, but visible by 4096, 8192, sorry. Since it's a secondary priority, but it's still a lower priority number than the others, it would become the root bridge, and traffic would be directed toward it if something, say, happened to your root bridge. So that's the basics of the root bridge and how it works.